welcome you to the house of our God and Savior on this beautiful day. Just to give a message. Well, we have a couple of questions that we have to answer. And in the course of the service, we're going to work through them. So right now, I ask you to open your hearts before our God in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. When you were found in great dependence, guilty of all sins brought into the world by Adam and Eve. But we live as saints and sinners and fall off in the commitment and in sins. Therefore, let us confess our sins to God. So in Christ who has come forth from the grave victorious, here's what God gives us. We declare Christ is risen. Take that and cast the darkness that is still in us and turn it to the light. There was love as it is good. That the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, that repentance and forgiveness of sins be proclaimed in his name. That word is proclaimed to you. In the name and for the sake of our risen Savior, I forgive you in the name of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He is risen indeed.
Triumphant
over sin. O loving Lord, you rose on this day to to announce the verdict that through you salvation may come to all people. Grant all this to be a verdict of victory over our enemies, which would destroy us forever. I invite you to be seated for the readings. Today, too, my dear friends, we do turn our attention to the Word of God that we have to do. And Isaiah the prophet, God spoke of today. And we hear this first blessing. Listen for the words of joy and care God speaks to his people. Isaiah the prophet writes this: "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing, and her people in joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying. No more shall an infant from their womb but a few days, nor an old man who is not fulfilled his days. For a child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruits. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of the trees, so shall be the days of my people. And my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. You shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble. For they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. It shall come to pass that before I have been called and answered, and while they are still speaking and hear, the wolf and the lamb shall be together, the lion shall eat straw and nuts, and dust shall be the serpent's tooth. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountains. Thus says the Lord." We shall now be invited to one of the beautiful Easter songs that begins with a special rendition of the story. thank you very much. Appropriately, that song is kind of peace song. And it's all about Christ risen in so many ways. That's what our theme is today. I now invite you to turn to the second reading this morning with me. And we do say, Paul says, there is a reason why there is an eternal resurrection joy. Listen, as he tells us that reason in our epistle lesson here this morning. Now that lesson was written for us in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, 15th chapter. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead, and then become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. But each one in his own order, Christ first fruits, afterward those who are Christ and his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom of God to the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. This is the word of the Lord. I'm going to write the theology of this.
Yeah.
not stand up. But Jesus Christ is risen today. He's one of those empty. He demands that we stand up and say, for just a few moments. See, it was a beautiful, quiet morning. Kind of like when I got up this morning down by the stage, it was clear as a bell, full moon, it was calm. I can almost imagine about 40 degrees warmer, but like it would have been for the women that morning. The minds were events of a good Friday, somewhat subsided in their minds. And even those most involved back on Friday and prior days were cold this morning. On this quiet, serene morning, there seems to be only one remaining question. What is the verdict? Now, for those of you who have not had an opportunity to be part of our lesson series, we have prosecution and defense attorneys putting various people on trial all last night. And we had to come to a verdict. We came to a verdict every worship service, but this morning we have to bring, what is that verdict? Who will roll away the stone? Who will open the grave? And this is even muffled by the mysterious stillness of the day. Who will open the grave by rolling away that stone? Let's look around and see who we can find. Will the devil roll away that stone and open that grave this morning? Absolutely not. The whole thing that he is doing, he's the one that started this death in process way back when he convinced Adam and Eve to turn against God. The one who hit that grave is his victim. Why? Who will open the stone? Will he open the stone? Story and show his achievements? Say the truth. The devil wants absolutely nothing to do with this grave. He wants this grave closed, sealed, and forgotten forever. And we'll go to any way to keep it that way. If this grave were open, it would reveal totally the lies that he has presented from the beginning of time and would show his complete defeat. There is a perfect remedy. And the verdict rendered is that Christ has crushed the devil's head. Well, he won't open the grave, so maybe the Jewish leaders, the church leaders, will open that grave this morning. I mean, after all, they were very boisterous Friday. They were the ones standing out in front of Pontius Pilate, yelling, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" I said, "Why? What's he done?" That's it, but I'm going to go to here during Passover. Jesus called the Christ of Barabbas, this murderous, rebellious character. God, they cried all the louder, "Crucify!" And then, and that out on Golgotha, they're the ones who jeered and sneered and ridiculed and chided Jesus. If you had Christ, come down and let me leave you. He did not have no intention of leaving him. I'll tell you the truth. The church leaders want absolutely nothing to do with this cemetery, this grave. Like his body was there. Then he is the third. They will have to admit that he is the Son of God. And his body is the third. Then they will have to admit that he will come with all of his angels and all of his power and judge all lies. And if they have to make up more lies to pile upon the lies they already spread. No, the verdict has been rendered. You cannot leave the church and hate the Christ. The verdict is condemned. All the devil, church leaders, moreover, the greatest. What about Jesus' disciples? You know, well, they need to want to leave the procession out of the cemetery and throw that grave open and throw their hands out and point to the human and say really loudly, Jesus is risen. Well, they point to the whole world and shout as loud as they can, we were right, he's risen. The Savior's salvation has come to all mankind. No, it's the truth. Jesus' disciples want nothing to do with that grave stone. Because we just made not the Savior that he said he was, they thought was going to be here. Maybe salvation comes in a different way than he proclaimed that it was. Besides that, there was a whole lot of anti-Jesus sentiment in Jerusalem in the area. Right now, it would be dangerous to identify with him at this point. I said that a verdict has been rendered. Fear will be replaced with mission. You got to lay these forward. Well, we got those key leaders who will not touch that. Hey, what about these women I'm telling you about? Will they open their grave? In the stillness of this morning, a group of women are moving steadily, yet stealthily, toward the grave site. Discussing that very question. Try to get it hard. Things happen so fast. There was so much emotion and heart. The physical and spiritual got all mixed together. You couldn't tell what you believed and what you felt all at the same time. And yet, to participate in this effort, even things were still on. He talked about what to do today as they move toward their grave. Can I tell you the truth, my friends? Yes, these women will open that grave. They will roll away that stone somehow. Why? Because they love Jesus so much. They were driven to do what is right for their beloved teacher. They had to correct the things that were done so wrong. Yes, they will get into that grave sometime. They'll open that grave and do all the right things and prepare his body for permanent burial. Yes, they will get into that grave. All the wrong reasons. And a verdict has been written. This understanding is turned into truth. And these women are sent to the message. What about today? Are there any today who would just assume that that grave remained closed and sealed forever? Countless multiple choices. Was that grave left just exactly as it? turns things to a way in trouble. When people are dying and buried, they stay dead and buried. Why are you surrounded with nature? Why just around too deeply with these things of God? The open grave creates more questions than answers. Just leave it alone. Besides that, the closed grave door right there. You know, Jesus died bravely, didn't he? Didn't Jesus die absolutely convinced of what it was he professed? Have been closed. Man is Lord. The master of this whole world. There's a great thing for those who want that grave closed right now. God says, fool. Like he said to the rich man himself, I can't know my body goes anyways. Beautiful love. I think it's a person, certainly in spirit. Everyone today is at the grave of Jesus. There's not a person on earth who is not at the grave of Jesus. I dare say you cannot go anywhere in the world right now and mention the name of Easter or the resurrection of Jesus and somebody will know about it. Doesn't matter whether they believe it or not, whether they like it or hate it. The verdict is ready. See it. The grave is open. Everybody sees it. It's been opened to the defeat of the devil. He has absolutely no power over it. Oh, he may tempt you and all that stuff. He has no power. The gate is open to the dismay of false churches and false church leaders. There's a verdict pronounced on them. Church leaders then and now, literally, Christ is risen. Promised Savior, living, conquered death and hell. That open grave is there for the one who is the disciples. He really is God. And the promised Savior who has conquered all of the enemies as he said he would. And he made it of the women. At that open grave, their friends were not. And good news to tell. That open grave is to the worry of many in this world, even right now, because God cannot be removed, no matter how you try. You can deny it, you can hate it, but you can't deny it. You will always be here. And his people will always be here, defending and proclaiming his victory. Wow. What a day for us. Open grave proclaims God's verdict. God's verdict is that the grave is empty not to let Jesus out, but to let us in. That open grave proves for time and eternity he is not there. That open grave says Jesus is risen. Death is defeated. When he is risen, salvation is when he is risen. Our sins are forgiven. He is risen. Our hope. Who will roll away that stone? Get it himself. And we're gathered here this morning of this beautiful morning to celebrate that. I look across the congregation. I didn't say what almost had to go out and kick teaching people in here this morning, because you want to stand out there and visit and interact and share your joy and love and excitement of the day with each other. But you don't want to make it come to another time. Always. How many times is it down there? That God called a hopeless day. This morning I see bright eyes, smiling faces. I see hope. The effect of the burden is written. Burden is written all over your face. It's written all over your attitude. It's obvious that you want to share the truth, the excitement that grave is open, the stone is broken, and you have won. Absolutely. I believe by this coming, yeah. That break that God has written all over you today is one word. It's saved. Yes, it is. Yeah, you go tell mom and dad. Because that's the verdict that you and everybody that's here is going to shout for all eternity. As you look at into that empty tomb this morning. By the way, yesterday we had a most marvelous day here at the church. I've never seen this done before. But we had a century great a tomb of Jesus. That was really cool. I was here with you when it kind of helped set it up, but you walked into the open tomb and from there there was a huge rock which wouldn't be like this nice smooth bowl of rock and harsh on your head. It would be hard on your feet. There was a burial table in there where they would have been Jesus. And as you walked through that, you got the idea of what it really meant to be Christ in the grave. But it really moved when our Lord went through. And then you walk up the back side into brightness. You walk down across the grass mat and get the kids to take their shoes off when it's right in the summertime and walk across that new water. That's resurrection. That's the feeling of the perfect grave. As you think about that empty grave, I hope this hymn is the hymn verse that just sticks in your mind. We're all there. That'll make you proud. I know how it's called. The writer said, "Hail eternal hope on high. Hail thou King of victories. Hail thou Prince of life. The Lord help you see this moment." And when you sing that, when you go out to live this, I absolutely guarantee you this, that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus now and then with all eternity. Amen?
Amen.
I'll tell you. In the excitement of this day, we have got the first thing we're going to do is I'm going to ask you to stand up and confess your initial faith with me in the words of the Nicene Creed. I
I also the cross of the cross of life, which is the
I now invite you to be seated. Because this is the day that fills our hearts, our lives with so much gratitude for our God that we desire to return those gifts, give our gifts to God. While we are giving our gifts to God, we will be treated to a beautiful song during that time. While you are looking up 461 for our auditorium, I just want to make a short statement. Probably some of the greatest musicians in the world have begun like this. I think it's just absolutely wonderful when God's children, and I don't care what age you are, share your gifts and talents with His church. This is the kind of stuff that makes worship worship. This is what makes everything we do in the church, everything we believe, with it. So I want to thank that little child for playing this morning. I think this is beautiful. And I encourage anyone, everyone in the congregation, to share the gifts and the talents God has given you. I'm going to invite you to go to the stage. I don't know if I'm human, but first one for an auditorium. In our time. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the abiding blessing of God rest upon our families, our neighborhoods, our places of business, our schools, and everywhere. Let us pray to the Lord. That those whose confession of the true faith leads to bodily harm or other sufferings, know relief and deliverance from every danger. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those whose labor has meaning, beauty to the life of the church, the musicians, artists, craft workers, flower raisers, and all others, they find joy and blessing in all they do to the glory of God. Let us pray to the Lord. That all those who know specific challenges, including those who are ill or suffering in any way, those who mourn, even those who rejoice, return to our Lord, all those who we mention now in our own hearts. And even those who we lay before you for healing, like Don and Gail and Cheryl and Roberta, and being swayed, who I just heard has been taken to the hospital and been put on an IV treatment together once, strengthened, build up, and give all of his back as necessary for health and normal living. Especially you may remember the family of Brother Gilbertson. For this very day, as we celebrate the resurrection, celebrate the resurrection with Christ forever. What a blessing. What a golden blessing to be there with him and hear all the angels singing in heaven, all the greatness that is his for eternity. Be with them, but heal those that are here in their loss and in their hurts. That all may know heavenly benediction and strength for each day. We say, let's pray to the Lord. These things and all else that we would have asked on this day of holy rejoicing grant to us, Lord, for the sake of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And now we prepare to receive the Holy Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly meet right and salutary that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially, I am about to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the whole world. By his dying, he was destroyed yet. By his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Thank you.
Christ on the same night in which he was betrayed and took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, gave to his disciples and said to him, "This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is in the New Testament in my blood, which is kept for you for the remission of sin. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." May this, the peace of the Lord, be with you always.
Take the drink of the blood of Christ.